Navy. And of late, they came out with some PR also, projecting their new warship. This is their new destroyer, the Zumwalt class, DDG 1000, very high-tech, very futuristic looking. Look at this, a one-man wrecking team with stealth capability. It can, according to design, it can approach the city without being detected and destroy the city using its array of weapons, guns, and missiles. And of course, the pivot to Asia Pacific, this has been long announced. And look at the deployment of forces of the U.S. in the Pacific area. They have divisions in South Korea, ships and aircraft in Japan. They're trying to negotiate with Vietnam for a stronger military partnership. In Guam, they're transferring their marine facilities in Guam from the Okinawa area. Of course, ongoing and under review by the Supreme Court is the EDCA, the Expanded Defense Cooperation Agreement. They deployed 2,500 Marines in Northern Australia. They have already positioned LCS. That's the home base of LCS in Singapore. And they're talking with Thailand also for a joint vision statement for stronger military alliance. And they came out with a new U.S. Asia-Pacific maritime security strategy. And one of the components is to build the capacity of allies and partners. And then they're supporting India's up east. You know, India, I'll talk about this later, India is now looking east. In other words, looking not just in the Indian Ocean, but also looking east towards the South China Sea. And embracing India as a net provider of security in the Indian Ocean region and beyond. Japan is there. Japan is smaller population-wise compared to China, but Japan has a big, powerful military. And they already stated that the South China Sea security has an impact on their national interest. In other words, to them, the South China Sea is a national interest issue. And they're thinking about expanding Navy patrols to the South China Sea. They also changed their defense policy. Their two bills were approved by their diet that would enable them to be more proactive in using their military, not only in defense of their mainland, but also to defend countries outside for as long as the threat to the country is also a threat to their national security. They had a very boisterous debate in their parliament. You know, when Japan is attacked, or when a close ally is attacked, and there is sort of threatens Japan's survival and poses a clear danger to the people, they can use that to mobilize their overseas military capability. When there is another appropriate means available, there is no other appropriate means to repel the attack and ensure Japan's survival and protect its people. And the use of force is restricted to a necessary minimum. Their old doctrine and policy was to defend Japan, to defend mainland Japan, but now they're extending the use of their military to defend other countries whose survival will pose a clear danger to the Japanese people. Now, I'll show you how they debated these two bills in the Japanese parliament and what is the result now. That's the Japanese parliament debating. Thank you. course, immediately after that approval of the Japanese diet, China warned Japan over expanding military role abroad. But Japan has come out with a record defense budget. The defense budget is in the tune of about $42 billion, the highest so far. And if you look at some of the details here, you can see what are their thrust. They're talking of helicopter destroyers. They have an existing already, a big one and a smaller one. This helicopter destroyer is convertible into a fixed-wing aircraft carrier. It is about 800 feet long, so it's quite it's long enough. They have submarines. They're considered to be among the best builders of submarines in the world. If Australia is planning to order submarines from them. They have big destroyers, Aegis class, two Atago, four Congo, and they can manufacture their own planes also. Mitsubishi, you're familiar with Mitsubishi. 213 F-15 made by Mitsubishi. 89 F-2. This F-2 is quite advanced also. And on order, and this will be a game changer, 42 F-35A to be delivered next year, and an additional 28 added to the defense budget. So how many would that be? That's a total of 70 F-35A planes that cannot be matched by any aircraft in the present inventory of the Chinese military. This is the F-35 Lightning. And recently, just last month also, middle of last month, they also showed up. They had their own military parade, but in this particular case, it was a fleet review. A fleet review participated in by vessels from India, South Korea, Australia, France, and the United States. And what is very curious is that the commander of the third fleet of the U.S. Navy, third fleet is based in the U.S. West Coast, was in the same ship as Prime Minister Abe during that fleet review. India is also there. India is the dominant power in the Indian Ocean, and it's not small. India to monitor shipping in the South China Sea, they already announced that. And they announced they are not going to hesitate to use naval power to protect economic interest in the South China Sea. What is their economic interest there? Oil. They have a joint development project with Vietnam, which China is protesting. But India announced they are not going to hesitate to use naval power to protect economic interests in the South China Sea. What is India's military power? They have two aircraft carriers. In fact, they are even ahead of China in the use of aircraft carriers. They have 9 kilo-class submarines, 9 stealth frigates. They can construct their own stealth frigates. There's a third aircraft carrier under construction in India. They have Akola class nuclear submarines, a lot of planes also, and they're about to move their oil platform into the South China Sea. This is another area, point of interest, because if they do this, the question now is what would China do? This is another point of potential conflict in the South China Sea. China already warned Delhi. India should rethink its oil exploration plans. And India of late, using CNN, have been boasting of the warships that they have constructed already. And there's a video of the latest warship. So it's a game of Yusai War, which is what's going on here. Thank you. quartet in the Indo-Pacific area. And what is this quartet? Australia, US, Japan, and India. So this is the emerging, very powerful alliance to counteract the assertiveness of China. Australia is there also. Australia has a very modest armed forces. They have some old submarines which they plan to replace, ordering maybe from Japan. But they already raised very strong objections to China's aggression in the South China Sea. They made their position very clear. When they had a change in government, a lot of people thought that there might be a change also in the policy of Australia. But immediately upon taking over, new Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull issued a very strong statement that China is pushing the envelope in the South China Sea. In other words, overextending in the South China Sea. And the late defense minister also made another strong statement that they are opposing the intimidation and aggression in the South China Sea, a veiled warning to China. Vietnam is there also. And the most potent weapon system of Vietnam is their order of 6 kilo class diesel submarines, and I understand that three have been delivered already. $3.2 billion worth of kilo-class submarines from Russia, which when deployed and utilized, can wreak havoc on the PLA Navy in the northern part of the South China Sea. Vietnam has fighters, they have some old submarines. But look at the comparative number of combatants. That's China with 303. Next is 67, Japan. Indonesia has 61. Vietnam has 37. Malaysia has 23. And the Philippines has 14. These are the naval combatants. And here are the maritime law enforcement ships. These are Coast Guard surveillance ships and Bureau of Fisheries ships. China has 205. In fact, this is being pointed out as the frontline weapon system of China, the white ships. It's very difficult to deal with them because it would be technically wrong to deal with it using a gray ship. It would look like you're attacking a civilian using your weapons. That's why they have this good strategy. And against them would be 78 from Japan, 55 from Vietnam, 8 from Indonesia, Malaysia 2, and the Philippines 4. These are the law enforcement. This is one area where we should really do a lot of improvement also. The EC raised concerns about China's advances in the South China Sea. G7 as well, about the reclamation. And very surprisingly, you can see here the realignment of forces. ASEAN already urged to stand up to Beijing over the South China Sea, whereas last year they were a little hesitant, but in the foreign minister meeting this year, no less than Prime Minister Najib, in opening the foreign minister summit, issued that statement that we should take a more active role in safeguarding regional security. Southeast Asian nations back halt to run land reclamation. And of course, the Philippines, what the Philippines are doing, Philippines' number one weapon is diplomacy, which is a very good weapon, as we can see. We filed a case in the Philippine, in the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague. And we have alliances with Japan, US, Mutual Defense Treaty. We have EDCA, which is subject to review by the